Good morning. How are you today? We are blessed in Jesus' name. We thank God for a glorious morning. I mean a glorious morning, a glorious week. We are beginning. We are the most privileged people on the face of the earth. Us who know God and who serve Him in His truth and in His spirit. Praise the Lord. We don't have to take for granted this privilege. You know, we are always introducing the week on Sunday. We always introduce the week on Sunday. We dedicate it to God. And then we begin. So if you begin, that Sunday has been given as a first fruit by the disciples of Jesus. Because Jesus rose from the dead. Chapter number 16 of Matthew, of 1 John, not 1 Corinthians, you can read about it. The reason is simply because Jesus rose again that day. And they felt we can celebrate that this day as we begin the week. Before, the Sabbath was on Saturday, but they changed the days. In the Old Testament, they were so much about Saturday or Sabbath day, as they call it, but God gave us a new revelation. That's why we are working on this day. So today, when you worship God, you lift everything before Him for the remaining 6 days. So you should expect progress, increase, expansion. How do I call it? What do you want? You know, as I don't know, this is not Bible that said, it might be this just an statement by somebody. He said, you will get what you expect, not what you want. And something surprising is many of us believers, we expect the negative to happen to us, even when we are beginning the first day in the presence of the Lord. Hakuna kazi, sijui hakuna nini, mimi mgonjwa, sijui. Praise the Lord. I'm not praising God because of those manenos, but I'm saying when we begin the first day in His presence, we must expect by the end of the week, we are more than those that began the week. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we are more. This is something that we have to acknowledge and accept and admit in our heart. That now that I'm a new creation, the life of a new creation is not the same as the life of the old man. And many times we want to operate from the old man or from the nature of the old man. Our thinking is always taking us back to that fallen creature who's always crying, having self-pity, always mourning about his situations, about his time, about the year. The people are not happy about the new year because of their condition. Corona. So what are we happy about? You see, for us, whether corona or there's no corona, our life continues. Our progress is inevitable. So when I begin the first day in His presence, I should expect the best week that week. I should expect the best report. You know the best report? The best report that week. The day before yesterday, somebody brought to our attention some information. I was planning to have a class here, so the message came at 4:30. And it's a bit, then we settled, we met at 1. As I was sitting, we are sitting with Sheikh is there, some other several Muslims are there, and several believers are there. As they were talking, so I asked myself, who am I among these people? I said, I'm a new creation. So what they are calling problem to me is not a problem. Yesterday, I said, now, we prayed about whatever was happening, and what happened is I was convinced in my spirit that God is in charge. Praise the Lord. God is in charge. And I told them I don't need to sit anymore in this meeting. God has taken over. Praise the Lord. I realized my problem ended the day Jesus died on the cross. Even if sometimes some of the things are of, we did of our mistakes. Well, when you do mistake, what do you think your father does? Will he say, "Mimi sijui deal na yeye"? Will he do that? At whatever cost, he will pay. So there's God in heaven. There's a Father in heaven who is bigger than all these others. All this problem that we talk about. You know, and now I have peace in my spirit. And when there is peace, there is peace. Praise the Lord. When there is peace. Even if there is a problem that you are anticipating to happen in this week, and then you are consecrating the first day for the Lord, the problem is taken care of by God. Praise the Lord. He is supreme. He's great. He's mighty. He's mighty. So let's move on to what we are to speak. I'm still talking about time. Today I want us to look at Lent, what we should be doing in the year 2021 in line with the will of God. You know, you celebrated the new year. I don't know whether they celebrated in heaven. Was there new year in heaven? They didn't celebrate. But heaven knows that there are things to be done at this time by the people on earth. Now, if you celebrate the new year and you're not doing what heaven expects, that is a loss to God. Cindy, you are taken to school, you are busy playing football, and you are very poor in academics. So by the time you come out of the class and you bring some report form to your parent, what will they say? Forget about CBC. I know the current curriculum, they are cutting, they are getting, taking care of that. So you will be considered as a failure. You didn't go and do what? Because from morning to evening, you're sitting in class. Then at 4, you go to the field. But I don't know what you're doing in class, but you emerge as the best player, football player, in that place. You came out with a clean E. Will your father or will your parents be happy? They'll not be happy. So you wasted the whole year playing football when you should be getting a clean A in some subjects. Now that is the reasoning of man. Now, celebrating this year, jumping up and down, is a bit surprising. Some of us are celebrating in pub. Some of us are celebrating in pub, waiting for the new year. Umeshika taska. So you come wanaruhusiwa wale kungoja mpaka saa sita, because I think some people spend some time in, I know even in this town, waiting for the new year until 1, until 6, until 12. And then ameshika nini? And then the guy is just celebrating, this is the new year. This is what they do. So the question is, are we understanding why God gives us time? And if we don't do what He expects from us, irrespective of how you celebrated, whether you slaughtered some mbuzi around or some chicken lost their lives, which other ones? Samaki, you know, sijui kama samaki inakufa ama inakuja kama imekufa. Samaki, sijui Whatever you put there, you celebrate you, it is all in vain. It is all in vain. Even in our churches, we wait. Paka 20th. Then we, all the night, you're just running all over, screaming, doing what? And then when God looks at the time he gave you and what you did with it, he says, waste of my resources, because the water you're drinking is not yours. The food you're eating is not yours. The place you're sleeping, even that bed is not yours. He can call you any day and he remains with his property. The vehicle you're driving is not yours. Everything. So he feels like this person who have rented him this earth, you know, it's a rent. We are in a rental. Even the body you are in is a rental. For information, it has been rented to you. You will be asked, what did you do? So spending all this time on earth, celebrating, doing things that is out of his will. So of what use is it to us? Of what benefit? When we have done all this, only to realize we are outside the will of God. I was speaking on radio yesterday, I was saying, even churches are outside the purpose for which God has given us the time we have. From the beginning of the year to the end of the year, the church is not doing what God expects of them. In church in Marsabit, I'm talking about church in Marsabit. So we may celebrate to make him be here, only to finish the 12th month doing our own things and falling out of the will of God. Is God surprised, or is God impressed with the kind of worship we did here? The praise we did here, at least we enjoyed. I think sometimes, you know, when people sing praises, you want to enjoy yourself. I think beside the praising of God, why do people want songs? Some of us are just there just to do some exercise, put some joy on our face. But by the end of the day, if what God said has not happened, are we doing anything? Nothing at all. We're doing nothing at all. You work, you do businesses, you accumulate millions, you do all these things. But at the end of it all, there is nothing about doing what God says. It is painful to God for us to celebrate the new year only not to be in his will. So being in church does not mean being in the will of God. Is that true? Yeah, being in church does not mean being in the... In fact, you can be in the church and so much in the world. That's very true. So last week we are trying to also just bring you to... I was bringing to your attention the time we are in. I still want to continue from there. I know in 30 minutes I will have done what I want to speak. I will speak very fast to present something to you. Chapter number 12 of 1 Chronicles. We still read the same verse we read last week. The Bible says, and of the children of Isaac, which were men that had understanding of the times, to know what Israel ought to do, the heads of them were 200, and all their brethren were at their command. The Bible says this children of Isaac, and this is a tribe in Israel. Isaac, I said, is one of the child of the son of Jacob. And the 12 sons became, the 12 sons of Jacob became the tribes of Israel. Now, this tribe of Isaac, they knew, the Bible says they had understanding of times. They understood exactly what time they are in and what Israel ought to do. That's what the Bible says here. And because they had understanding of what Israel ought to do, the Bible says they had command over others. In other words, they are the ones that are ruling who are ruling the others. If you don't understand why you are right now and somebody understands it, that somebody will will have to have influence over your life. The Bible so here says they had understanding of times and what Israel ought to do. Now, whatever Israel ought to do, who is bringing that? Who has designed the things that they are to do? God is the one who has designed. In other words, when we appeared on the face of the earth, we didn't just appear accidentally, not knowing what not to do or what to do. Even before they were born, God has a covenant with them. Something is written down that as they arrive on earth, they must learn who their God is. And they must know what God expects them to do in their generations. Now, if you read chapter number 6 of the book of Deuteronomy, God was instructing the parents. He says, teach your children, whether you're walking, whether you're sitting, whether in the house, wherever you will be, teach them. Let them know what my intention is all about their lives. That you speak while you're speaking to parents to teach their children. So that there is no day that they will live without understanding what they are expected of God. Chapter number 12 of the book of Exodus, when they were celebrating the Passover or the Genesis of Passover, God was telling them, this is now for us it is April, for them it will be January. He says, this will be the beginning of your year, the first month. Whatever you're doing here, do it every year and inform your children. If they ask you, why are we doing this? Why are we doing that? Just tell them, at a time like this in history, God delivered us from. And pass to them all the things that they are to do. What I'm saying is, even us when we arrived, we didn't arrive accidentally on the planet Earth. And every time that anybody comes on the face of the earth, God has a specific purpose that he's accomplishing in that time. Now, the time we're in, Jesus calls it the times of Gentiles. Jesus calls it the times of Gentiles. I explained to you how the times of Gentiles came about last week. Let me read it. 21, Luke, verse 24. Luke chapter number 21, verse 24. The Bible says, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Just until. Now he's saying this Israelites, because they rejected Jesus, and whatever God was planning to do through them. You see, the idea that God had when they received the gospel as a nation, he was to give that same gospel to the rest of the world. But they refused. So he closed their calendar with them, and he opened a calendar for people who have never known him. All the tribes on the face of the earth. So when he talks about Gentiles, I think I was explaining here on Friday, even Peter, you know, I don't know if they didn't understand Jesus well, because in fact Jesus even told them that in chapter number 16 of John. He said, I have so much to give you or to tell you, but right now you cannot understand. And the truth is, the apostles missed. God had to bring another apostle by the name Paul to send to Gentiles. Because these apostles are still feeling Gentiles don't deserve the salvation that we have received. That's why Paul could be shocked if, as he's speaking, the Holy Spirit feeding on the Gentiles and people speaking in tongues, Peter is wondering, what is this? So, the time, I'm trying to see, I'm understanding something. They were preaching, the apostles, after Jesus left, the Holy Spirit came upon them, they were preaching.
but they were avoiding Gentiles. They could hardly eat with them. We have read chapter number 1 of Galatians. We saw that one. Even chapter number 2. We saw they were avoiding. And imagine Jesus declared this statement before he left. But they were avoiding Gentiles. Gentiles should not be preached to. Gentiles. They were just preaching to Jews themselves. To only Jews. Until God had to anoint somebody by the name Paul. And then he tells Paul that you are my instrument to turn these people back to me. And he went out. Paul went out. We're talking about the times of Gentiles. Now that they refused to accept the gospel, God handed over the time to Gentiles. So that now the calendar for the Gentiles are opened with God, and these other ones were closed. Now we read chapter number 46 of Isaiah, verse 9 and 10. The Bible says, I am God who declares the end from the beginning. Now look at this book of Revelation, chapter 7. This is what John saw. Chapter 7 from verse 9. Let me read. John saw these things. And remember, John saw this thing before he died. John, before he refused even to die. I think it's good to refuse to die. And they want to boil him in oil. The oil was over. The man is still standing inside. They took him from there. They put him, they threw him on island of Patmos so that he'd be consumed by some wild animals. And wild animals were not wild, really. He still existed. And that's how he wrote for us this book. And he says, after this, I'm reading from verse 9, chapter 7. After this, I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, amen, blessing, and glory, and worship, and wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor, and power, and might, be unto our God forever and ever. Wow. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and where come they from? And I said unto them, sir, thou knowest. So what we are seeing is all, what we are seeing here is John seeing the kind of people he never expected to be in heaven, He saw in a vision. Chapter number 15, when you study the book of Acts, what you realize is they were now wondering, now that these people are saved, what do we do? John could not accept, Peter could not accept, James said some light into that. But later, then God is opening the eyes of John to know that even these people can be saved. I read to you where I said this is the times of Gentiles. Jesus spoke. His disciples could not understand. Now, if you read chapter number 3 of the book of Ephesians, if you read, you understand. Chapter number 3 of Ephesians, Paul says, this thing that has been hidden from the generations, from people, from the time the world was created, was revealed to me. He's talking about the ministry to Gentiles. Just this thing has been hidden from everybody except me. Can you speak that language? That's powerful. So this thing has been hidden from many. Let me just read that. You know, I'm inspired by that. Let's just read and we see what we are talking about here. And then we see what next. For this cause, I'll Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me
to your word.
How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of God, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. It has been hidden from others, but has been revealed to me. Hidden even from Peter, James, John, because they could not put aside their culture. They're still living like Jews, not like Christians. This has been hidden from them. Now that I am been given this opportunity to speak to you, to bring you to Christ, even if others are fighting you, he says, I am here to defend you. I was sent. This is powerful. Imagine they were considered as dogs by Jews. Even Jesus called them dogs. Don't give the food of children to dogs. Chapter number 15 of Matthew, verse 24. That's what they are used to call. They were used to call it before the New Testament was ratified, before the written Testament was introduced. Even Jesus was still living under the law, just like Jews, and telling these people don't deserve the miracles that I do for you. This miracle specifically for Jews. He even told his disciples, do not go to other nations of the world. Just limit yourself to the lost children of Israel. That's what he told them. So you can imagine, I think, I don't know if that first statement is what tied their mind to only Jews. Because he told them, when you read chapter number 10 of Matthew, you'll find that. He says, when you go out, don't go outside. Just be within this area. So that's how they didn't understand. But what we need to understand is, after these Jews rejected Jesus and then didn't receive him as the Messiah, God gave their time to Gentiles. And he closed his calendar with the Jews. The calendar of the Jews, we said, of 490 weeks. Of 490 weeks. We only not weeks, sorry. Of 70 weeks. You can find that one, chapter number 9 of the book of Daniel. All the other years have been lived except 7 years that was remaining. God was to finish the 7 years with Jews and then move to Gentiles. But because they refused, he gave time to the Gentiles. So that now the gospel has to be preached to the whole world. Chapter number 24 of Matthew, verse 14. Let me just read somewhere there. That's what Jesus was telling his disciples. Now this is, he's telling them when he's almost finishing his meeting. And then Jesus told them, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. And to all nations. Jesus is still talking about Gentiles. All nations. Jews are just a nation. The word nation simply means a specific kind of group. So Jews is just a nation. But when he's talking about nations, he's talking about different ethnic groups all over the face of the earth. He said this gospel will be preached. And we said last week, I still want to repeat, we've been given 2,000 years as church. Let me read that one. 2,000 years for that to happen. Hosea chapter number 6, verse 1 and 2. Come and let us return unto the Lord, for he has torn and he will heal us. He has smitten and he will bind us up. After 2 days will he revive us. And in the third day he will raise us up, and we shall live in his sight. A After 2 days, one day is equal to 1,000 years, it will take us back to himself. Meaning, after now the 2,000 years of the preaching of the gospel has happened, which is not far from now where we are, because as we are talking right now, all nations of the earth have heard the gospel. Let's not say people have not heard. With all this internet all over, things that are coming up every year, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, WhatsApp, talk of all this, even them that could not access this, the gospel is reaching them. People are preaching so much all over the world. So we realized we might be remaining with at least 10 years or less if you follow what has been preached here. So after this, the calendar goes back to Gentiles. So the question is this: now that we understand the times, what is our business? What is our work? Kazi yetu ni nini? When he left, he gave us this commission. What did he say? Matthew chapter number 28. A very common verse that every preacher will quote whenever he stands to preach. Great commission. And Jesus came from verse 18 and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Baptizing all nations, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. He says, go teach. Make disciples of all nations. Now, if you read until NIV version, it talks about making disciples of every nation. I think in King James version, they're not giving us that. So the business that Jesus left the church with is to preach the gospel and to make disciples. That's the business. Irrespective of whatever you are engaged in, even if you're not a pastor, it is your responsibility to make the gospel move forward. Evangelism and disciple making. Those two things. Evangelism and disciple making. Not just evangelism, also disciple making. There's power in disciple making, because if you make disciples, you'll multiply yourself and you do more. Evangelism alone is not really of help. Many have been evangelizing all through. And I think something surprising about the church in Kenya is we hardly learn from even what our mistakes. Many times we've been preaching the gospel. See, when we were in university, we've been going, every year we go for around 2-3 missions. All of us, we decide to go. Tunaenda Garsen, tunaenda Mboni. Mboni is in Makueni. Tunaenda, those are the days when I was in college, before I went out. So it's a big privilege to go around this place, even if it's expensive. So to kind of chaptize, see, to kind of, we've been going to, we came to Meru, we went preaching while in, then sometimes we are sent back, go and see. There's a time we went to a place called Bumula, and then I was in charge of the discipleship, and I wanted to know how many disciples, over 250 got saved in that area. So we were sent back to go and visit those pastors and see how many people have been retained after getting born again. Something surprising, we didn't even find one. The pastors told us we didn't even see them. And we see the churches all over. So if somebody's coming from here, we just look for this pastor, we give you to him. And you see, for him, the pastors want members, but they don't want the expense of retaining members. The aspect of working on this person to grow spiritually and to stand. So we realized, even after working with Weso after college in Western, the same problem is what they saw. We preach. Weso even got there for 14 weeks, 14 days. until I think the last few years before I left there, I told them, give me the aspect of discipleship only. We tried that one also. As people get saved, we put them in class, in a specific church. We teach them every evening. But even at one point, so we only find some few. And we tried all this. So what I'm simply saying is, the biggest responsibility we have is for the gospel to be preached and disciples to be made. That's the reason as to why we are alive. When I went to Mombasa the other day, Baku was telling me, Baku is just one of us in this place here. He says, they leave no place to chance. They go to prisons. All high schools, there's a way Pastor Liars has organized them so that all high schools, somebody's going. All prisons, somebody's going. That guy was telling me that they were even moving to Tanzania, to Uganda, to Western, to preach. I'm talking about Bake. He says, we don't, even when we are seated in a vehicle, he's preaching. So they're not leaving any place without preaching. And that is what they have been doing. They've just finished service, they begin preaching. Somebody gets up, they bring, and then you are given responsibility to take care of that one who got born again. You. The same thing with Pastor Chris. I was talking to Miret. For those of you who know Miret, Miret is also part of the Pastor Chris system in JQuat. She also said to me the same. Every Saturday they go for 2 hours to evangelize. And after evangelizing, somebody gets saved. Now, she is given the responsibility. So if people are around, if the people that are born in your hand are around 3, 4, 5, then you're given the responsibility to begin a fellowship with them. And to bring more. So you become a pastor of those people. The cell thing we are talking about. Pastor Chris has a cell conference where he speaks to cell group leaders. And anybody, like you see, as many of us as are here, if we begin preaching, and I ask you, all of you, as somebody gets born again, you take responsibility of his spiritual life until he stands. So that is how people are doing. And this is, they're doing it day in, day out. That's how you see these big churches grow. So if we are not doing that, irrespective of how millions you're making, how many millions you're making, if disciples are not met, people are not being saved, then then we are wasting God's time and resources. And then imagine, these people going to hell, into the lake of fire, after this, when we have been given the responsibility to deliver them from the kingdom of darkness. Is it not painful? It's very painful. This kind of preaching you not hear in our churches. Putting responsibility on every member to think about a lost soul, and to think about discipleship. You don't hear. Now, if we don't do it in this year, who will do? Because I already know we are not doing. I bother some young people God is raising. Uko chini naona shambole. Some people are putting shambole on fire. Today they are going to Badasa to preach there. I think every evening down here, they're doing a lot of conferences, a lot of crusade down there. I think that's great. That's great, but it's a threat to MPF. It's dangerous. It's a threat. What are they doing? They are asking questions. So, we should not lose the purpose of the time we are in. Lai and Chris tells people, including Yodepo, if you are a business person, then you should be the great financier of this gospel. You make profit, you send it there. You make profit. Who's preaching like this today in our town here? You make millions, you build your offer and you sleep in. And then that's you look for the best vehicle, you sleep in. And you just go around showing that you're very rich. And the church is dying. And the more you make money, the more you need to bring for the gospel to be preached. And people are doing that. I was reading a book by Robert Morris. He put up the biggest church. And Bill Habel also, these are guys who have put big church in US. They say when they see a giver who is also a big business person in the town, they say they disciple them to give more. They disciple them to give more so that this work happens. But enter in here, because our people are not taught the importance of this preaching and making of disciples. Even them that have millions, you see, what shocked me is we are raising money to build a church. Somebody has millions in their account, but he brings 2,000 or 10,000. He doesn't have a sense of responsibility when it comes to the lost and making of disciples. Because the pastor in that church is not looking for the lost, he's not making disciples. So the amount of money that should be going to the kingdom of God to expand the kingdom is staying in somebody's pocket, just feeding his stomach and bringing too much of pressure and diabetes and tell us what each other sickness. They are not enjoying themselves. They are not enjoying life. Which life will you enjoy when you're not fulfilling your purpose in life? No life. No life. So this time, I'm saying, is the time of preaching the gospel like never before. That's why we need to move to new territories. God will open a way if we are ready to go. So by the time 2021 ends, how many people have reached? Are we reached? How many disciples have we made? That's all God is looking at. So when the 2021 closes, before you celebrate, put for us the figure there of your success. How many disciples did I make? How many people have I preached to? Because if that is not there, my friend, it doesn't matter how you play keyboard and there's no disciple. It doesn't make much to God. It doesn't make much sense to God. Let me read for you somewhere. 1 Corinthians chapter number 3, before I finish with the last verse. I will be reading almost the last verses. Wow, I think I've lost it. I've lost the place. Is it 2 Corinthians? In the somewhere Paul talks about the work of everybody will be tested. And them that their work will not survive, the fire will be burnt, and themselves they will be saved. You see, their work is burnt and they are saved. That is, who knows that verse? 3 verse? 13, 14, 15. Thank you. I got it wrong. I was thinking about 16. I think that's why I missed it. The Bible says from verse 10, according to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I've laid the foundation, and another builds thereupon. But let every man take heed how he builds thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. For if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. Verse 15 says, if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Now, how do we know the work that stays and not burned with fire? He's talking about There are so many things that you used to build the house or your work on. It talks about silver. It talks about gold. And then it talks about hay, stubble. It's talking about these woods, yeah? And he's talking about, so for them that are using something like wood and grass, he says the fire will burn. And he says, now the people that you have raised, how many of them will survive the temptation of this world, the trials of this world, the problems of this world? And how many of them will be standing? If all of them are fallen, you can imagine. Because your work is known by the kind of people you discipled. Are they standing? After they stood, can they make more disciples? Can they multiply? If almost of them are going back. You see, that's why gathering people is not really the main purpose of a church. Gathering people is not. Establishing them into the word of God is the main business. To a point where they stand, and they're also causing more other people to stand. In our churches today, many people are falling off and going to other faith. The work of many are tested right now as we are talking. The work of many are being tested. I know many pastors are not finding it very hard to contain people into their rooms. Some are just containing by all means so that they remain as pastors. But the truth is, they cannot make disciples out of them. They cannot make them obey what the word of God says. Let's not talk about pastors. Let's talk about ourselves, because let's not transfer this responsibility to somebody like me who's now preaching, yeah? Now, pastor, his work is to preach, to make disciples. You have responsibility. I mean, you have. Bago was telling me, whatever we are told, if you bring somebody, you are responsible until that person stands. You have to make him used to this state or the kind of the church we need to, the programs, whatever is there, fit him in. So that at least, as you're trying to bring this person in, the pastor is also hitting him from every corner, so the man stands or the woman stands. So the responsibility lies with all of us, not some of us, all of us. Everything about us, even when we go to work, has to be about discipleship and evangelism. Discipleship and evangelism. So if we live with this kind of understanding in the year 2021, by the end of the year, I think we can celebrate better, in a better way, than the way people are just talking about. Congratulations, you arrived in the year 2021. Congratulations for what? What did you do? How much have you accomplished? As I finish, I want to read a verse. In Romans chapter number 13 from verse 11. Romans 13 verse 11. The Bible says, "And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is so far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, and not in strife and envy, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." It says the time is fast spent. And the truth is, where we are standing, the time is fast spent. We have few years to the coming of Jesus. If our understanding of the time of Gentiles is 2,000 years, as we have studied, then we have as less than 10 years. We have talked about it. And last week we said, if the 7 years of tribulation is part of this 2,000 years, then we have less than three years. I think that one should bring more sobriety to us. Exam iko karibu. Exam, nje tukiona timetable ya exam, hata kama ulikuwa ukilala unaamka na unaanza kusoma.
hata kama utaweka miguu kwa maji usiku mzima lazima usome.
So Paul is saying the time is more nearer than we think. Let's now wake up even if we are sleeping, and let's put our work, our task to this.
I remember what Rogers told me. He called me that morning when he was to travel, and I told him I'm already in the church. He called me at 4:00, and he told me, "You see, you've got it." And I asked him, "Why do you think? Why have I got it?" He said, "If as by the prediction of Pastor Chris and others who have given us that calculation, if that is true, then this is the right thing to do as we wait for Jesus." This is the right way. Waking up early, praying, being so busy in the work. I think it's truly, and he said, from the time church was opened on 6th of July, he said he didn't drop microphone the whole 7 months. Is it 7 or 6? 6 months until he came here. Every day preaching. Because he says that is the way to go. That doing crusade everywhere. Because that is the work Jesus left us to do. So the time is not there. So looking around at these people who are not born again, we need to do something about them. Any opportunity God provides, I was speaking to teachers. Something surprising me is that they are told not to allow any stranger in the compound, including parents. Some of our teachers are a bit like Mama Favor and Mr. Dennis, a bit aggressive. They said we are sitting in class the way we've been sitting. So what is wrong with us having? And they are pushing until I spoke to Moi girls, I spoke to Sasura. They are telling us they really don't accept, but Sasura aliambia wacha nisukume tu principal nione kama ataniruhusu. We don't know. This is the time that the Antichrist is coming forcefully to bring everything down and to come in. You see, when Chris was screaming about that from March last year, people thought it is just a lie. It's not a lie. So that they are almost refusing this preaching to happen in schools everywhere. So we should not take this opportunity, this time, just kama masaya kawaida. See, choose masaya kawaida. Understanding this time, let's just be busy preaching. If Jesus appears in the next 10 years, well, if not, we are still on the right. We continue doing what he asked us to do until we find ourselves in heaven. So even seeing this kind of opposition to some of this work, we must pray. We must pray. Must pray. I want to stop at that point. Maybe do a worship as we take the Holy Communion, and then we finish our...